Welcome to the Representations of Finite Groups course. This is the 19th lecture. Today we are going to talk about McKay's irreducibility criteria for induced representations. So in lecture number 17 we defined induced class preserving functions, and in lecture number 18 we defined induced representations. Also in lecture number 18 we saw plenty of examples of induced representations, and we observed that starting with an irreducible representation of a subgroup, the induced representation may be irreducible or may not be irreducible. So today we are going to find a necessary and sufficient condition for the induced representation of an irreducible representation to be irreducible. So let us develop some background for proving this criteria. So let G be a group, H a subgroup of the group G. Let phi from H to GLDC be a representation of the subgroup H. Then we know that induction of phi from the subgroup H to the group G is a representation of the group G to GL of MDC, where M is the index of H in the group G, and D is the degree of the representation phi. So to find out whether induction of phi from H to G is irreducible, we want to use the irreducibility criteria, namely find the inner product of the character of the induced representation with itself, and find whether find necessary and sufficient condition when that is 1. Also we know that the character of the induction of phi from the subgroup H to the group G is simply induction of the character of phi from the subgroup H to the group G. So to determine whether this induced representation induction of phi from the subgroup H to the group G is irreducible, we want to use the irreducibility criteria, that is determine conditions under which this inner product induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G, induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G is 1. So we need to determine this, so we need to understand this inner product. But now by Frobenius reciprocity, we can rewrite it in the following form. This inner product induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G with itself, induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G, this is just same as inner product of chi phi and then restriction of the second factor, the induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G from G to H. So we need to understand what is this composite operation. So let us try to understand this. Before proceeding further, let us observe the following. Let phi and psi be two representations of a group G, then the characters chi phi and chi psi of phi and psi respectively are orthogonal if and only if the representations phi and psi do not have any common irreducible constituent. If and only if phi and psi do not have any common irreducible constituent. So let phi 1, phi 2, so on, let us say phi k be a complete list of inequivalent irreducible representations of the group G. Then by Matschke's theorem, each representation is certain integer linear combination of these phi i's, right? It's a direct sum of this phi 1 to phi k, possibly with some multiplicity. Then phi can be written as say m1 phi 1 direct sum, so on, direct sum mk phi k, and psi can be written as n1 psi 1 direct sum, so on, nk psi k, where mi's are bigger than or equal to 0, and ni's are also bigger than or equal to 0. Then Let us compute the inner product chi phi of chi psi. This by definition is same as, we know that the character of direct sum of two representation is the direct sum of their characters. So this is same as m1 chi of phi 1 direct sum, so on, direct sum mk chi of phi k inner product with n1 chi of psi 1 direct sum, so on, nk chi of psi k. Since the inner product is linear, this distributes, so this implies that inner product chi phi chi psi, this is same as, now we know that characters of inequivalent irreducible representations, they form an orthogonal set in the space of all class preserving functions. So therefore we get m1 n1 plus so on plus mk nk is inner product of chi phi with chi psi, where recall that each mi is bigger than or equal to 0 and each ni is bigger than or equal to 0. So this implies that chi phi and chi psi are orthogonal. So that is the inner product chi phi with chi psi, this is 0 if and only if for each I at least one of them is 0, at least one of mi or ni is 0 for each I. For each I, at least one of them is 0. And this happens if and only if phi and psi do not have any common irreducible constituent. So characters of two representations are orthogonal if and only if they do not have any common irreducible constituent. In order to understand induction of a character from a subgroup to the group G and then restricting it further again on the subgroup H, we need the idea of what is called double cosets. So here is a definition. Let G be a group and H and K two subgroups of G. H and K are arbitrary subgroups of G, they could also be same or one of them could also be trivial. Then there is an action of this product group, then there is an action sigma from H cross K to the symmetric group on the group G. So there is an action of the product group H cross K on the group G given by sigma of any H K, it will act on a group element G, and the action is as H G K inverse. One can easily check that it's indeed a group action, and the orbits of this action are called double cosets, denoted by, say, double coset of a group element little g. So H little g K, this is a notation, and formally, as I said, this is simply H G K, where H is in H and little k is in K. Since the group H cross K acts on the group G, you have the orbit space or the set of orbits of H cross K action on G, and this set of orbits is denoted by the following, denoted by this notation. Notice that if H is a normal subgroup of the group G, then this set of all double cosets of H cross H in G is simply the set of all cosets of H in G. Then G mod H is just same as G mod H. So why it is the case? Consider an element. So let H G H prime be an element of H G H, where H and H prime are of course elements of H. Then, so this element H G H prime, I can write it in the following form. I can write it as G G inverse times H G H prime. This is just same as G times G inverse H G into H prime. But where is this element? This element G inverse HG is again in H because it's a normal subgroup and little h is in H. So therefore G inverse HG is again in H. H prime is already in H. So therefore this falls in the coset G capital H. Conversely, any GH belonging to this left coset GH can be seen as this GH, I can write it as 1GH, where 1 is of course the identity of the group, which is also the identity of the subgroup, which is of course in HGH. So this implies that this double coset of little g in the whole of the group G with respect to this pair HH is GH. H is just the left coset GH. Let's see an example. Let us take G to be the group of all 2 by 2 invertible matrices over C, GL2C, and take B to be the group of all upper triangular matrices A, B, 0, C, such that AC is not equal to 0. Then, if you try to find out the set of all double cosets of BB in the group G, then G mod B, this is finite. In fact, it has only 2 elements, namely B, because B is just B, identity B, that is just B, and then B times this element 0, 1, 1, 0 times B. This B is also called the Borel subgroup. The point, important point to be noted here is because the set of all double cosets of a pair of subgroup HK in the group G is the set of orbits under certain action, so they certainly partition your group G into disjoint equivalence classes. These classes are precisely the double cosets. But unlike cosets, the order of a double coset need not divide the order of the group G. That is one important point to be noted. Remember that if you take any subgroup of a group G, then the set, then the order of any coset is precisely the order of the subgroup G, which by Lagrange's theorem divide order of the group G. But that does not happen for double cosets. Order of a double coset need not divide order of the group, and also orders of different double cosets may be different. Note that if G is a group and H and K are 2 subgroups of the group G, the group G is a disjoint union of double cosets of this pair of subgroups H and K. H, little g, K. Let us take one more example. Let G be the symmetric group S3. Okay, we know that S3 has how many elements? 6 elements, 1, 1, 2, 2, 3, 1, 3, 1, 2, 3, and the permutation 1, 3, 2. Let us take H equals to K and both of them to be the cyclic subgroup of order 2, consisting of 1 and 1, 2. Let us find out the double cosets. What is H? Identity of the group, and K is the just H, which we know is 1 and 1, 2. And what about H? Take this transposition 1, 3. 1, 3 and K. Write it down. Element as identity from both H and K, you get 1, 3. And if you take 1, 2 from the first and trivial from the second, you get 1, 2 into 1, 3. In the other case, you get 1, 3 into 1, 2. Right? And the other possibility is 1, 2, 1, 3 and 1, 2. But you can see this is just same as 1, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 2 and 2, 3. So the first coset H1K has 2 elements 1 and 1, 2. And the second coset H13K has the remaining 4 elements. In this case, the group G is H1K disjoint union with H13K. And as you can see here, the size of the double coset H1K is just 2, whereas size of the double coset H13K is 4 elements. So different double cosets can have different sizes. This is completely different from how left and right cosets of subgroups behave. And secondly, look at the size of the second double coset H13K is 4. It does not divide order of the group G, which is 6. So let's move on. We now prove Mackey's decomposition theorem, which tells us how the induction of a class preserving function followed by restriction can be decomposed in terms of double cosets. Theorem due to Mackey: let G be a group, H and K two subgroups of G. Let S be a complete set of double coset representatives of the pair HK in the group G. Let S be a complete set of double coset representatives G, H, K. Then for each class preserving function, f in the center of the group algebra of the subgroup K, we have the following, that restriction from G to H of induction from K to G of this function F is given by this formula: summation as S runs in the set of the complete set of double coset representatives of this pair of subgroups, induction from H intersection with K superscript S to H, where K superscript S is just conjugate of K by S, of restriction of K superscript S to H intersection KS. Notice that H intersection KS is a subgroup of KS, and H intersection KS is also a subgroup of H. Of this conjugate class preserving function, we denote it by F superscript S, where K superscript S is just a conjugate of S, which is SKS inverse, and F superscript S is this new class preserving function, which is given by on an element X, it is just F of S inverse XS for X belonging to K superscript S. Notice here the interchange of the operations. So we want to express induction followed by restriction of a class preserving function, and this is a sum over the complete set, over a complete set of double coset representatives of pair of the subgroups of this factor, when the factor is first restriction of a conjugate of F followed by induction on appropriate subgroup of H and KS. Namely, just take the intersection. You may note here that if K is a normal subgroup of the group G, then what is K superscript S? It is just K. Therefore, the right hand side is a summation over S, restriction of K by H intersection K, followed by induction of from H intersection K to H. In this case, the restriction and the induction are from K to the intersection, and then from intersection to the other subgroup H, the non-normal subgroup. So let us prove this. We are given that S is a complete set of double coset representatives for this set of double cosets. For each little s in this set of representatives, we have the subgroup H intersection KS of H. Intersection of two subgroups is a subgroup where KS is simply the conjugate of K by S. Let VS denote a complete set of left coset representatives of this subgroup H intersection KS in the subgroup H. This implies that the subgroup H can be written as a disjoint union of V of H intersection with K superscript S, where V is in V sub S. You take any little s in S and conjugate K by that, K take its intersection with H. So you get a subgroup of H. And again, we can ask for a complete set of left coset representatives of this subgroup H intersection Ks in H. Label it as V sub S. Now, since left coset form a partition of the subgroup, therefore your subgroup H can be written as a disjoint union of left cosets of this subgroup H intersection Ks of H. Now consider the double coset HSK. What is this? Now I replace value of H there. So H is just this union, disjoint union of V of H intersection with Ks, where V is in Vs, into S into K. All right. But what I do is the following. I can write this as disjoint union of V, this left coset of this subgroup H intersection Ks, as V run in this Vs, and on the right of K I multiply by S inverse S, so that I can write it as conjugate of K times S. So it can be written as Ks times S. Now look at this expression. I have a left coset V of H intersection Ks, and then I am multiplying it by the one of the groups, which is Ks here. So the output is simply a left coset of Ks. And here the disjoint union, there is no guarantee that the union will be disjoint, which we are going to prove in a moment. So this can be written as some union of V belonging to Vs of this left coset V of Ks times S. But K superscript S is simply S K S inverse. So again, I plug in the value. This is same as V belonging to Vs and V into S K S inverse into S get cancelled. So it is simply a union of left cosets of the subgroup K, okay, as the summation run over the indexing set Vs. We claim that the union is disjoint. Let's prove the claim. So if Vs of K is same as V prime S of K for V and V prime in the set Vs, then what happens? What does this equality of left cosets of K means? This implies that S inverse V prime inverse Vs is in K. This implies that V prime inverse V is in S K S inverse, which is your Ks. But where are these V prime and V? V prime inverse into V is also in H. So this implies that they are in intersection. This implies that V prime inverse into V is in H intersection with Ks. So if they are in Ks, this implies that they denote the same left coset, which implies that V prime of H intersection with Ks, this is same as V of H intersection with Ks. But V prime and V are in Vs, which is a complete set of left coset representatives of H intersection Ks in H. So this implies that then V has to be V prime by the definition of V, Vs. So therefore the union that we have here in star is a disjoint union. So let us write T sub S as, so this little s I have fixed in my set of double cosets of the pair HK in the group G, okay? So consider this as T sub S, which is all those Vs such that V is in the set capital V sub S, which I defined in the previous slide. And let T equals to union of this T sub S, where I run this S in the complete set of double coset representatives of the pair of subgroups HK. My claim is that this is a disjoint union. Why that's the case? Suppose that there is element in common. Suppose that TS intersection with TS prime is non-empty for S and S prime in the set S. This implies that Vs is same as V prime S prime. For sum, V in Vs and V prime in V of S prime. Now Vs is a complete set of left coset representatives of H intersection with Ks in H, and Vs prime is a complete set of left coset representatives of H intersection Ks prime in H. So therefore V and V prime both are in H. We are going to use it. This implies that I can write little s as V inverse V prime S prime, and which implies that the double coset HSK can be written as double coset H V inverse V prime S prime of K, where V and V prime both are in H, so it get merged in H. This is just same as H S prime K. So I have two double cosets HSK equal to HS prime K, where S and S prime are from the set S, which is a complete list of double coset representatives. So this implies that S has to be same as S prime, which further implies by using in this circle equation that V has to be therefore V prime. This T is actually a disjoint union of T sub S, where S is in capital S. The group G is a disjoint union of its double cosets. So it is disjoint union of H little s k, where S is in capital S. But each double coset S small s k, we have been able to write as a disjoint union. So this is same as disjoint union of S in S. And then disjoint union of V in V sub S of Vs into K. But this is same as the disjoint union. Again S in S, and I can now vary it as T in T sub S of little t into K. Because T sub S is just by definition all those Vs where V is in Vs, right? And here I am talking about Vs, this left coset Vs into K. So if I replace Vs as T, this T should vary in Ts. And this is again disjoint union, which we just showed. Also, we just showed that T is a disjoint union of this Ts. Therefore, this is just same as disjoint union of T into capital K, where T is in capital T. Because T here by definition is union of Ts as I run little s in capital S. So therefore G can be written as a disjoint union of left cosets of K as I vary this variable T in capital T. This implies that T is a complete set of left coset representatives of K in the group G. We are now ready to prove the main identity. So consider restriction from group G to the subgroup H of induction from K to G of a class Bezierian function on the subgroup K, and evaluate it at an element of the subgroup H where H is in H. Because the final operation is restriction, so F is a class Bezierian function on K, we apply induction to get a class Bezierian function on G, and then we further restrict it to a class Bezierian function on the subgroup H. So I take little h in H. Now since I have already taken little h in H, so I can remove this restriction sign. It is just same as induction from K to G of function F on H. And in the preceding slide, I computed a complete set of left coset representatives of the subgroup K in the group G. And we know how to write induction of a class Bezierian function in terms of a complete set of left coset representatives. So this is therefore same as summation as little t vary in that complete set of coset representatives and f dot of t inverse ht. But this is same as t is a disjoint union of ts as s in s. So s in s, and then summation t in ts of f dot of T inverse HT. This is same as summation little s in S, and I know that T is Dijan union of TS, and TS by definition is VS, where V is in V sub S. So therefore I can rewrite this as V in V sub S, and F dot, not each little t is in TS, which consists of elements of the form V into V S, where V is in capital V sub S, and S is of course in S, right? So I can replace this T by V S. So this is same as V S inverse, that is same as S inverse V inverse H V S. But this is same as summation S in S, and of course V in V S. And now recall the definition of dot of a complex valued function. So this is same as F of S inverse H V S, provided S inverse V inverse H V S is in the domain of the function F, and F is a class preserving function on K, so it is in K. So where S inverse V inverse H V S is in K, equivalently V inverse H V is in S K S inverse, which we know is, we are denoting it by K superscript S. So therefore this is same as summation little s in S, summation V is in V sub S, V inverse H V in the S conjugate of K. Now I have F acting on S inverse V inverse H V S in terms of S conjugate of F. I can write it as F superscript S acting on V inverse H V, right? Because V inverse H V is in K superscript S. Observe that V inverse H V is also in H, because little h is already is in H, and V is also a left coset representative of H intersection K superscript S in capital H. So therefore this element is also in H. So therefore this summation is same as summation S in S, summation V in V S, and V inverse H V in K S, but is already in H, so I can very well write it as K S intersection H of F superscript S acting on V inverse H V. Now notice the following: F superscript S is being evaluated at V inverse H V, which is an element in K S intersection H, whereas F superscript S was originally a function on K superscript S. So therefore what is written here can be thought of as restriction of F superscript S on K S intersection H. So I can rewrite it as summation S belonging to S, summation V belonging to V S, and V inverse H V is in H intersection K S. And since F superscript S is evaluated at this point, I can think of it as a restriction of F superscript S acting at V inverse H V. From where? From K superscript S to H intersection with K superscript S. Observe the following. This is just same as summation little s in S. What is V sub S? V sub S is precisely the set of left coset representatives of H intersection K S in H. And I am summing up a function over this set of left coset representatives of H intersection K S in H. So therefore it is induction of this function. So this is same as induction. From where? Because this function is restricted on H intersection K S, so it is from H intersection K S. And to where we are inducting? The induction is going all the way up to H. So to H of this function which I have circled. So this is the function, so which is same as restriction from K superscript S to H intersection with K superscript S of F superscript S acting on H. Okay, because you may recall the definition of induction of a class possessing function. It is just F dot of conjugate where the conjugating element runs over coset representatives. And here V is running over VS, which is the set of left coset representatives of H intersection KS in H. So we can write this summation in this form. So this proves the theorem. So we have now built up all the necessary background for proving the Mackey's irreducibility criteria. So let's prove it. Very beautiful theorem. Mackey's irreducibility criteria. Let G be a group and H a subgroup of the group G. Let phi from H to GLD C be a representation of H. Then we can induce this phi to a representation on G. Then the induction of phi from the subgroup H to the group G is irreducible if and only if the following two hold. There are two conditions. First is phi itself should be irreducible. And secondly, the representations, restriction of phi from the subgroup H to H intersection with H superscript S and restriction of phi S from the conjugate of H to H intersection with HS do not have any common irreducible constituent. Equivalently, they are orthogonal as we showed in a preceding slide. Where is this S? S should not be an element of H, is an outside H. And what if phi superscript S? As usual, this is a conjugate representation of an element X, is just phi of S inverse XS for all X in H superscript S. You may observe here that if H is a normal subgroup of G, then the condition number 2 become quite simple. Because H intersection H superscript S is simply H. So we are talking about restriction of H on H, which is nothing, just the same representation. So second condition is equivalent to saying that phi and phi superscript S are disjoint for all S which are outside the subgroup H. So for normal subgroups, the Mackey criteria become quite simple. So let's prove it. So as said in the beginning, we are going to compute the inner product of the character of the induced representation with itself. And from there, we will deduce that that is 1 if and only if condition number 1 and 2 hold. So let S be a complete set of double coset representatives of the pair HH in the group G. And also we can assume without loss of generality that suppose that 1 belong to S to give the trivial double coset, to give H1H, which is just H. Once we have set a complete set of double coset representatives of the pair HH in the group G, we can apply the preceding theorem. So we get restriction from G to H of induction from H to G of character of this representation phi of the subgroup H can be written as this sum. Summation S run over the coset representatives, double coset representatives, and induction from H intersection HS to H of restriction from HS to H intersection HS of chi phi conjugate. Notice that we have taken identity in the set of double coset representatives. So if you plug in S equals to 1, chi phi S is just chi phi, and S superscript S becomes just H. So restriction from H to H is nothing, and induction from H to H is nothing. So it is just same as chi phi, plus we can separate out the non-trivial elements. So S belonging to S minus the identity element. Induction H intersection H S restriction S superscript S H intersection with HS of chi phi of S. So having noted this, now we take the inner product of the character of the induced representation. Induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G, inner product with induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G. By Frobenius reciprocity, this is same as inner product of chi phi, and then take the restriction. So restriction from G to H of induction from H to G of chi phi. And this we have just computed above. So plug in there. So which is same as inner product of chi phi and this sum, that is chi phi plus this sum over non-trivial cosine representatives S belonging to S minus singleton 1 and induction from H intersection with HS to H, restriction H intersection HS S superscript S chi phi S. But inner product is linear, so it separates out, so it is same as chi phi plus inner product of chi phi with this summation S belonging to S minus singleton 1, and write down this lengthy expression again, induction H intersection HS, restriction from S to H intersection HS, and S conjugate of this character chi phi, and take this inner product, which again by Frobenius reciprocity is same as chi phi plus summation S belonging to S minus 1 of inner product, and now this induction become restriction from H to H intersection with HS of chi phi and restriction from HS to H intersection HS of chi phi S conjugate of that. So you can see that we have applied Frobenius reciprocity twice here. Also we have used linearity of the inner product. So therefore inner product of character of the induced representation with itself is same as inner product of character of the original representation plus sum of these inner products. Now observe the right hand side of this equality. Now notice the right hand side of the last expression. Look at the first term, chi phi inner product. Phi is given to be an arbitrary representation of the subgroup H. So we write it as a direct sum of irreducible constituents. So character of the representation phi therefore will be a linear combination of characters of the irreducible constituents. And we are taking inner product of this direct sum of irreducible characters with itself. And we know that characters of inequivalent irreducible representations are orthogonal, okay, in the space of all class preserving functions. So therefore, inner product chi phi is going to be simply sums of squares of the multiplicities of irreducible constituents. So if phi is like n1 phi 1 plus n2 phi 2 say nk phi k, then chi phi is simply n1 square plus n2 square plus nk square, where each ni is a non-negative integer. So therefore, the inner product chi phi with itself is an integer bigger than or equals to 1. Notice that the inner product chi phi with itself, chi phi, is bigger than or equal to 1 and is an integer. Now look at the summation. So in the summation, we have this inner product restriction of chi phi from H to H intersection HS, inner product with restriction of chi phi conjugated by S from H superscript H to H intersection HS. Given this representation phi, we have constructed this conjugate phi superscript S. So whatever are the irreducible constituents of restriction of phi on H intersection HS, you will get corresponding irreducible constituent of the restriction of phi superscript S on H intersection HS. So therefore, by the same reasoning, it turns out that each inner product here is non-negative. Similarly, each of these inner product restriction from H to H intersection H superscript S of chi phi with restriction from H superscript S to H intersection with HS of chi phi conjugated by S is non-negative real number. Thus, this inner product of chi phi, induction from H to the group G and induction of chi phi from the subgroup H to the group G, this is 1 if and only if inner product of chi phi with itself is 1 and all other terms are 0. So this proves the theorem. In fact, we have proved something stronger, that the induced representation is irreducible if and only if the original representation is irreducible and the representations restriction of phi from H to H intersection HS and restriction of phi superscript S from S superscript S to H intersection HS are disjoint for all S which are non-trivial double coset representatives of the pair HH in the group G. So in fact, we don't really need to check this condition, second condition, for all element outside H. We just need to check for double coset representative which are non-trivial. So let me conclude this lecture with two remarks. First remark is the following. The proof of the Mackey's irreducibility criteria shows that we need to check the second condition only for S belonging to S minus 1 and not for all elements of the group G minus the whole of the subgroup H. Mackey's irreducibility criteria become very simple if the subgroup under consideration is normal. If H is a normal subgroup of the group G, then it is simply H. And H intersection H superscript S therefore is also H. So restriction is not really making any meaning here. Thus the Mackey irreducibility criteria can be stated in a simpler form as follows. If H is a normal subgroup of a group G and phi a representation of H, then the induction of phi from H to G is irreducible if and only if phi is irreducible and phi and phi superscript S are inequivalent for all S in S minus 1. Notice that if phi is irreducible, then phi superscript S is also irreducible. If there are two irreducible representations, then they do not have any common irreducible constituent, is simply equivalent to saying that they are not equivalent. So these are the two remarks that I wanted to make here. So I will stop here. Thank you.